Who was that masked man? We'll talk about it on this episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast.
The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guests and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged. This episode is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform. Avoid the mystery of one-sided deals. Connect with Fundwise to get the very best funding you can qualify for fast. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. It's easy. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You did hear me correctly. I did say start or grow your business. If you don't have a business yet, but you got a solid business plan, they can help you get funding. Get the best funding you can qualify for. Their strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, and bridge loans. They work with real estate, startups like I already mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really easy. Just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddog. That's apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Get money for your business now. Apply.fundwise.com/minddog. One of us is. Welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. Am I talking a little fast? good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight, we're going to talk to another author, yet another author, an author of historical fiction, and one that it is based, the latest book, anyway, is based on classic radio days, which you know I'm a big fan of. I'm also a big fan of Westerns. So the subject matter is one that I am very interested in. Stephen G. Eoannou, I've been practicing that for at least 2 minutes now, is the author of two historical novels, Rook and Yesteryear. Yesteryear launched just yesterday, and he's been on a whirlwind media tour, and I'm the one who's complaining that I'm tired. Looking at the schedule that he's been promoting this book on, makes me tired just looking at it, and I'm the one complaining. It coincides with the 90th anniversary of the Lone Ranger's radio debut, and the book is about the backstory of the Lone Ranger and has a lot of historical fact in it mixed with some really intriguing fiction. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Stephen G. Eoannou. Stephen, welcome.
You did a great job with the name.
Well, I don't usually, but thank you for being here. As I mentioned, you've been on a whirlwind media tour promoting the book that just launched yesterday. You must be exhausted and tired of answering the same old questions.
No, it's been a lot of fun. Everyone's been great, and everyone's kind of intrigued by the book just because it's so different in its subject matter, I guess.
It is. Now, the Lone Ranger, in this thing you have things about the plot to kill FDR. I don't know if that was real or not. With my problem with historical fiction, and I say this every time we have somebody who writes historical fiction, is I have a tough time discerning what's fiction and what's reality. And sometimes that could get me into trouble because I will argue that it's all truth and nonfiction, and that will get me in trouble. So is that part of it a real, the attempt to assassinate FDR?
No, that one's not true.
See, I would have.
What happened, I was doing the research for the book, and I was reading a lot of newspapers from that time period just to get into the feel of the era. And you never know what you're going to stumble across. And I stumbled across an article when FDR came to Buffalo in 1932 when he was running for president as for his first term. And in the article, they laid out his entire route that he was going to be taking, when he was going to be at the hotel, you know, when he was going to be at the hall. And it just, you know, that certainly wouldn't have happened today with the times that we live in. And I just thought that was so fascinating, but it was right there in the, you know, the Buffalo News, Buffalo Evening News. And so I incorporated that trip to Buffalo, but then I threw in the assassination attempt.
Interesting. So it sounds like you were in the lot, because I don't think you'd find that Buffalo Evening News articles online, or maybe you did, but it sounds like you're doing a lot of microfilm research and things like that.
Getting nauseous and the microfiche machine at the Buffalo Central Library.
Very cool. Is that where you're located in Buffalo?
I am located in Buffalo, New York, and the setting of my two historical novels, Rook and Yesteryear, also are set here.
Oh, very cool. Now, but I was under the impression, and I could have wrong, is that Lone Ranger started as a radio show in Detroit, not Buffalo, right?
Well, you're almost right. Fran Striker, Fran Striker, who was the writer and the creator of the Lone Ranger, was a Buffalo writer, and he worked at WEBR radio here in town, which is still on the air today. And he was a script writer, a radio script writer. And as you know, back in the day, in the 1930s, the radio stations had their live dramas and comedy on the air, their own orchestras, their own actors and actresses, and their own writing talent. And so Fran was a script writer, but he had to support about a dozen families that lost everything during the Depression. So as a side hustle, he was sending out scripts that had already aired on WEBR and was selling them to other radio stations across the country to Wow. make a few extra bucks. And he would, you know, charge anywhere between $2 and $7 a script. And one of the stations that was buying his material was WXYZ in Detroit, owned by a man named George W. Trendle. And by the end of 1932, Trendle was buying 3 or 4 scripts a week from Striker. And he, I almost said emailed. He sent him a telegram. I am tired. He sent him a telegram saying, hey, can you write us a Western, you know, and put in all the hokum. That was the word he used, hokum. Which is a great word. I want to bring it back.
Yeah, I want to start using it too. That's a cool word. I like it.
But into that, and then he said, all the hokum. mass riders, girl tied to railroad tracks, you know, 2-gun bank robbers. Can you do that? And Striker said, sure. And he went to his file cabinet and he pulled out a script that he wrote 2 years earlier. It was a series that was airing in Buffalo called Covered Wagon Days. And he, for whatever reason, he chose episode number 10. And he repurposed it and rewrote it and got feedback from Trendle and the folks at WXYZ and came up with the Lone Ranger character. And the Lone Ranger, as you said in the intro, premiered 90 years ago this year, but the premiere was in Buffalo. They did a little test run at WEBR before it moved to Detroit and WXYZ, where it was all through its radio life.
Well, you got to admire the entrepreneurial spirit there of Fran Striker, but I don't think you could ever get away with that. He was like a one-man syndication on his own without really looking into the legalities of all that kind of stuff, because I don't think you can get away with that anymore, like just selling scripts. You had already run someplace and resell purposes.
Yeah, probably not. But, you know, but think of when streaming movies and TV started and everyone was starved for content. That's the same thing that was happening with radio in those early days, right? They needed something to fill the time. Right. And so they were turning to guys like Striker for content. But remember, this is 1932, right? So no copying machines, no computers. So he's typing these scripts on a typewriter, manual typewriter, obviously, in carbon paper. And he's trying to strike the keys as hard as he can, so maybe he can get 2 or 3 copies, you know, off of one carbon, so he can send it out to 2 or 3 radio stations at a time. Trying to sell these scripts. So he was under a lot of financial pressure, and you got to do what you got to do.
I wonder if any of those recordings are available from different stations of the same exact script. Did you find out any of that in your research?
Oh, that's interesting. I didn't look into it. But that would be interesting to do a little side-by-side comparison.
Right, different actors, different commercials.
That'd be fun. Might be the next book.
So before I, because I want to get into this idea of the Lone Ranger and where he got it from, and I'm sure you came across that in your research, but what was the impetus for you? I mean, were you a all-time radio fan? Have you been like, is that something that you had been exposed to?
Yeah, I grew up listening to the Mystery Theater on radio with E.G. Marshall was the host.
Wow.
And
you don't look old enough for that. Maybe I missed something here.
Yeah. I was, you know, in the 70s, that was still on the air. Yeah. Wow. And so I used to fall asleep listening to the Mystery Theater. And then, of course, Dr. Demento. And, you know, I always loved old movies. And then also in the 70s on albums, they started releasing some of the old radio shows on 33 and a third albums. Right. And I bought a few, and I still have them. They're hanging up in my office on the wall now, but it was like, you know, Bogart and Bacall and To Have and Have
The
Not.
Shadow, all those scripts. Yeah. I love that stuff. We were talking about Orson Welles' stuff the other day and how he became a star in radio. And that, it was a different time where radio was, as you say, it was the, you know, the Netflix of today. And it was all the rage. And it was a family thing where families gathered around a radio in the living room. Fascinating.
Absolutely.
Time. So that's was an interest of you. What made you decide to write the book? Where did the idea to write this book come from?
Well, as I said, I'm from Buffalo. I'm a Buffalo-based writer. And I can't remember if I was at a bar or a party, but somebody had mentioned that the man who wrote and created The Lone Ranger was from Buffalo. And I said, absolutely not. I would have known that, right? Buffalo is very good about promoting the creative people who are from here or who had spent time here. And I would have heard if that was true. So, of course, I immediately whipped out my phone and Googled it. And I found out that not only was I wrong, Fran Striker was from Buffalo, but he lived in my neighborhood.
Wow.
he went to high school like two blocks from where I was living. He wrote the Lone Ranger scripts just north of me. He was a neighborhood guy, and I had never heard of him. And I couldn't figure that out. So I was kind of asking around. I said, have you ever heard of Fran Striker? And people would say, no, who's that? And I had a friend who was a school nurse at Lafayette High School where he went. And I said, is there like a plaque by the office or the stage, you know, about Fran Striker? And she goes, no, who's that? No one seemed to know his name. And so I dug a little bit deeper. And I think the reason why he's not a household name, because not only did he create the Lone Ranger, but he also created the Green Hornet and Sergeant Preston, the Yukon. I mean, wow. He had a huge influence on radio and 20th century pop culture, and nobody really knows his name. And I think it was because he sold the rights to the Lone Ranger for $10 to George W. Trendle, owner of WXYZ, before the Lone Ranger, you know, exploded and became a money-making machine. And then to make matters worse, Trendle started claiming in the 1940s that he was the one that created the Lone Ranger. And there was even a story going around that Striker didn't even join the team at WXYZ until after the Ranger had been on the air. And Striker was a very gracious man, and he never contradicted or argued with that story. And unfortunately, he passed away in the early 60s and never got a chance to write his autobiography. And I think that's why his name's kind of gotten lost to the everyday person. He is in the National Broadcasting Hall of Fame and the Buffalo Hall of Fame, Broadcasters Hall of Fame. But the common person, maybe enough years has gone by that he's kind of gotten forgotten.
I think, and I could be wrong about this, but I think Airport, the guys who wrote the movie Airport, Airplane, Fran Striker is in that. It's one of the characters' names.
Really interesting.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure I think it's a nod.
Yeah. Okay. Now, yeah. Absolutely.
I knew about, for some reason, I did know the name Fran Striker with a connection to the Lone Ranger. And this is what I want. Did you uncover the roots of the Lone Ranger story, where he got it from?
Not specifically. Part of my novel is my imagination taking over how he came up with it. But in real life, I didn't come across anything like that. And again, I said he died prematurely. He didn't get a chance to write his autobiography. So that secret was taken to his grave. I did come across some books and article that point to a real life figure from the Old West.
Bass Reeves.
Absolutely. Yeah. He was a runaway slave. Legend has it, he stole a Confederate horse from the Confederate Army and rode out to the Oklahoma Territory. And once the Emancipation Proclamation was announced, he became a U.S. Marshal. And he rode a big white horse, and he liked to throw silver dollars instead of silver bullets. He had a
Native
mask.
Indian. The mask thing is there's conjecture that it was just because of his black face.
Maybe, yeah.
He had an Indian companion too. I don't know if his name was Tonto or not, but yeah, a lot of that matches up. Fort Smith, Arkansas, Bass Reeves. I was just wondering if that was uncovered in your research with him knowing that story or digging in and really finding out about it, because there's so much of that. Listen, history is being rewritten all the time, and you don't know what to believe and what not to believe, but the Bass Reeves story always sticks with me.
Yeah, absolutely. And like I said, I didn't find anything specifically that was the inspiration for the Lone Ranger. Part of my research was when Striker died in the early 60s, his estate left all his papers to the University of Buffalo. And I'm an alumni. And so I was able to get into their special collections and go through, there was probably 24, 30 cases worth of stuff. The scripts, the telegrams back and forth, memorabilia, his typewriter. In fact, I had a friend who, when she was an undergrad, her student job, her work study job, was in the library, and they had Stryker's typewriter on display back then in the 70s. And she was an aspiring writer back then, and she would walk by and rub it for luck, hoping some of that creative mojo would seep into her fingertips.
Interesting.
Yeah. So it was fun.
Do you type on a typewriter, or you're? I would think, I'm just assuming you're a computer guy like everybody else. But I've lately talked to authors who write out longhand. Two last week, both write out their novels in longhand and then type them. Have you done the? Because there's something romantic about that.
I've got a few old typewriters around the house that. We grew up with as kids, but I don't use them anymore. I use the laptop, but I was just watching an interview with James Ellroy, LA Confidential, Black Dahlia, Perfidia. He writes everything out longhand still. A lot of writers think that gives them more control. Me, I can't even read my own handwriting anymore, so I got to type it out.
Right. That's so interesting. And John, the idea for the book is interesting, and I understand, I have not read it yet, but I understand it's a very fast-paced, almost a tribute to the old black and white Western movies, where it was just one tied to the railroad tracks type of Penelope pit stop after another. Was it meant to be an homage to the movies in some way, or old black and white Westerns?
A little bit farther back, it meant to be an homage to a radio play. So the idea was, let's have Fran Striker and his best friend, John Barrett. And I don't know if he was really his best friend, but he was the radio actor who played the Lone Ranger for the first time when it was a pilot here in Buffalo. Let's put them in an adventure story. I wanted to write an adventure novel about a man who wrote adventure stories. And he wrote radio plays. So the book isn't broken into chapters. It's broken into episodes. And the episodes are all named, like Slattery's Rings and the Gypsy's Curse and a Masked Man Appears. I have a musical interlude in the middle. So I tried to make it like a radio play starring the man who was a prolific radio playwright.
Very cool stuff.
So that was my thinking.
Let me just, because earlier you said he sold the rights for $10, and people listening now who have no context probably think $10 is $10. But 1932, in the height of the Depression, the worst part of the Depression, $10 was probably $100 or more, like in today's money, right? Not as brutal as it seems, $10.
Yeah, well, it was worth a lot of money, no doubt. Yeah. But you have to remember, Ed Fran wasn't dumb, and he wasn't a bad businessman. He was supporting his wife, his two children, and like I said, a dozen other family members. He was under tremendous financial pressure, and they're all dependent on him financially. And Trendle, whose nickname was the miser of Motown, he knew of this, and he knew the Ranger was probably going to take off. And so after about a year of it being on the air, Trendle approached Striker and said, "Hey, look, you know, why don't you leave Buffalo, come to Detroit, and work for me full time?" You know, at that point, Trendle was buying scripts from Lone Ranger scripts from Striker for $7 an episode.
That's okay.
So he said, "Look, come, I'll guarantee you have a job during the length of the Depression. You don't have to worry about that. You have job security. You'll be making more money than you ever earned to take care of your family. But in return, you have to sell me the rights to Lone Ranger for $10.
Wow.
So Striker was put in a hard position, right? I can take the safe bet and take care of my family. And Striker never had a big national hit. You know, he was still an unknown. Or I could roll the dice on this series that seems special. And Striker took the conservative route. He wasn't a risk taker. And he accepted, he signed the contract. And of course, the Ranger exploded. And to put it in context, Trendle bought it for $10 in 1934. And 20 years later, in 1954, Trendle sold the rights to the Lone Ranger for $3 million.
Wow.
So now that was just the rights that he sold. Think about in that 20-year period, all the Lone Ranger novels that Striker wrote, all the Lone Ranger comic books that Striker wrote, the comic strips in the newspapers, the toys, all that money went to Trendle instead of Striker.
Yeah, it's a lot of money too. You talk even that $3 million in the 50s. Again, we're prorating today. That probably sure. $300 million.
Yeah, who knows? Yeah, it was a lot of money. And Striker, like I said, never complained. He said, "Look, no one held a gun to my head. I made a decision, a business decision, to take care of my family."
Different and times, different people, man. Because today, the guy would be complaining. No matter what you're made of, you'd be complaining about.
He'd be on Twitter, you know, right now, complaining. You know,
yeah.
And Striker never did. And when Trendle started claiming that he created the Lone Ranger, his family and friends would ask him. He'd say, "Fran, doesn't it bother you? You know, why don't you say something?" And he said, "You know what? The people in the radio business, they know. They know it was me." And then in one interview, an interviewer asked him that, and he said, "You know, only God creates." So he never confronted Trendle about it. He continued working for Trendle at WXYZ until Trendle sold the rights in 54. And so they had a professional relationship.
Wow.
And he was just a really gracious man. I took away from him.
Lived up to the contract he signed. You know, that's so rare. I mean, you don't see that in any business anymore. No. Where if somebody signs a contract and they perform really well and they want to raise immediately and they want to renegotiate consistently, and you know, there's something to be said for character that you know, I'm not sure if that was what you were trying to portray in the book, but
yeah,
I appreciate him already. I like him a lot more just from this conversation.
Well, now, one of the things that Striker wrote for the Lone Ranger fan club was the Lone Ranger Creed. And it was like the Ten Commandments. This is the way you should behave like the Lone Ranger. And one of those tenets in the Creed is do what's best for the greatest number. And if you think about it, he lived that, right? Because he did what was best for his family. And so that creed that he wrote, by all accounts that I've read, is really an extension of his own values.
So, you know, what? Good for you for you know, highlighting that. But the question that brings up is his family, you know, does he have descendants? It sounds like he was a man of family and they probably have some descendants. Are they aware of this book and understand that you've done some good things to uphold his legacy and highlight his upstanding character?
Well, he was, he lived in Arcade, New York, which is about 45 miles from Buffalo. And he was actually moving back to Buffalo when he got into that car wreck and died. And he's buried out in Arcade at the family plot. His sons have all passed. He does have grandchildren and relatives in the Arcade area. And last night at my book launch, a man came up to me after the talk, and he was the town historian from Arcade and introduced himself. And he had heard about me. He had read some article in the local paper about the book. And he drove the 45 miles to the launch last night, which I was thrilled about. And I said, you know, I reached out to the Arcade New York newspaper. I haven't heard back yet. And he goes, well, I used to run that paper when I was younger. He goes, let me see what I can do. So I think sooner or later our paths will cross. And I'm looking forward to that and hearing some first hand anecdotes
very cool stuff. Now, if I may talk about the business aspect of this, because the cover Yesteryear and you got the typewriter, it definitely lets you know that this is a nostalgic type of book about a writer. That's what you get from the cover. And I'm just judging by a cover now, but it this book is far more than that. It is a really creative approach to writing a novel. And when you work with a publishing company, especially a company that has been around more than a year, they are tied to old school ways. This is the way we've done it. And you don't write a book with episodes. You write a book with chapters. Any of that pushback, any of the pushback from the publisher to say, you got to have something about the Lone Ranger on the cover. I mean, this, any of that kind of.
Well, it's interesting that you bring up the cover, because that was a little bit of a struggle. My publisher is SFWP. They've been around for, they just had their 25th anniversary this year. So they've been around for a while. They had published my short story, Muscle Cars, my short story collection, Muscle Cars. So I've worked with them before. And the director, Andrew Gifford, said, you know what? Our creative team is having a little bit of a struggle coming up with something for the cover, because the book is historical fiction, it's biographical fiction, it's comic, it's, you know, it's part noir, there's gangsters involved, it's magical realism, there's a lot of stuff going on. He goes, do you mind hopping on a Zoom call and talk it out? Which is pretty unusual for someone whose name's not Stephen King, So I said, of course, you know. So everybody was on that call. My editor, the director, the managing director, the layout person, the creative person, everybody was on this call. And the way we approached it said, okay, let's make a list. All right, what are all the tropes of the Lone Ranger? The mask, the silver bullets, you know, the horse silver, the six-shooter gun. So we made a list of those. And said, okay, what are the tropes or from the book or that era? And, you know, an old microphone, you know, the square kind, not the cool kind you got now.
Yeah.
But the old microphones from the 30s, the cathedral radio, the typewriter. Striker was a heavy smoker. He liked Lucky Strikes, you know, a pack of Luckies, you know, or a pack of cigarettes.
I'd rather fight than switch.
Right. So we put all these things. Okay, we'll work these in. And then what about colors? And I thought it should be a very bright, colorful, you know, fun cover because, hey, it's the Lone Ranger. It's comic books. It's comic strips. It's radio. And everyone said, no. Let's make it dark. Let's emphasize the noir stuff. And so the compromise was the coloring would be dark, but the font would be more cartoonish. It's kind of a tip to the hat. So we agreed on that. And then the artists went away and they came back. And after a couple minor suggestions, the cover is what you see. And I was really pleased with what the final product was. I was pleased that I was included in it.
The cover appeals to me, but it says author more than it says anything about the Lone Ranger.
Yeah, it does.
All-time author, like you know, the guy you see in black and white film sitting behind a typewriter and film noir type of stuff.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah, I get that. So, but I would think, because I know how publishing companies are. They're like music publishers, and they're like film. You know, where do you get off taking chances? We don't like chances. We want to put you in a box. And also, the fact that you touch on so many different genres that it might fall into, they like to put you in a box. They want it to be McDonald's hamburgers. Everybody the same every time. People know how to identify it quickly. And they think that's what works for business, and maybe they're right, but it's stifling artistically. So I would have thought you'd get some pushback by that.
Well, you know, it's one of the nicer things about working with a smaller press is that they give you that freedom, and they're more open to really creative things that appeal to them. And I was lucky that the folks at SFWP happened to really like this book.
Right.
So yeah, I was very fortunate to have them pick it up, I think. And there wasn't any pushback about any of the weird stuff I did in this book. So that was really a blessing.
Good for them. Now, a couple of things before I let you go, because this is intriguing to me. Now, the launch party you had last night for it, what kind of audience were you able to kind of get an idea of the demographic that this is going to? Because I'm an old man, and I this book appeals to me, but I'm not the juicy. People don't look at like, oh, that's the guy we want to sell to. And when they're doing marketing or anything like that, I mean, it's just, who is going to be more attracted to this book?
Yeah, I don't think of it in terms of age or gender, really. It was mostly thinking that the folks who like historical novels, I think, would like this book. Specifically, the folks that like the 1930s, that era, the Depression era. There's not a whole lot being written right now about that time, it doesn't seem. And that's the era that really appeals to me, the 30s and 40s. I think primarily because my parents grew up during that generation, and I grew up listening to their stories, especially my father's stories of Buffalo during that time. And a lot of my dad's stories made its way into Yesteryear. Jimmy Slattery was a boxing champion from South Buffalo, who by this time his career was pretty much almost over. He was an alcoholic, and you know they called him the next Jack Dempsey, and he did win the light heavyweight champion, but he didn't hold on to it. He's in the book because he used to come in my grandfather's restaurant. And my dad tried to throw him out one day because he was drunk and bothering the waitresses. Another boxer would come in my dad's restaurant who was also a drunk, an alcoholic, and he had a diamond pinky ring. And he would give it to my father to hold because he said my dad was the only honest man on Genesee Street. And wow. He would hold his diamond ring so he wouldn't lose it while he was on a bender. And then he'd come back and get the ring. So in my book, I kind of combine those two stories. And it's Slattery that gives Fran Striker the rings to hold because he feels a bender coming on. And of course, Striker loses them right away. And that's when the caper begins of getting back the stolen rings. So a lot of my dad's stories of growing up in Buffalo made it into this book. right. Which is kind of fun too.
And you mentioned the gangsters. Magaddino is also part of it. I mean, most people, if they're not familiar with mafioso type lore, probably don't know that name, but I do because it's part of my upbringing.
But well, he ran the mob for decades here in Buffalo, and right. never went to jail. And he was a funeral parlor owner. He was a mortician. He owned a couple funeral parlors, and his nickname was the Undertaker. And he had a crematorium in the basement of his funeral parlor. And one of the stories saying the joke was that the only thing working during the Depression in Buffalo was the Undertaker's crematorium, because that's where all his enemies would end up.
Yeah.
So I don't know if Striker ever crossed paths with the mafia. Probably not.
Right.
Or Jimmy Slattery, for that matter. But they all lived in Buffalo at the same time. So what the hell? Let's put let's make them characters in this novel.
Very cool stuff. I hate to put this kind of pressure on you.
Okay.
But this book, well, let's before we even get to that part, and save that idea for later. I promise I won't keep you forever. But I'm interested in, because the audiobook. Now, I talk to people about this all the time. I prefer to read, but the audience for audiobooks is so big now. People love audiobooks. There is a chance to do something super creative on the audiobook side of this to make it really come to life in terms of all time radio stuff. Have you thought about that? Is that in the works, or are you taking that kind of?
I think about that every day. and I have an agent that handles secondary rights, TV, movies, audio. So hopefully she is watching.
Yeah. Unfortunately, and the only stumbling thing is it would be more expensive than a typical audiobook where you get one narrator. You'd have to really audition people to read roles and stuff like that, just like an old-time radio show.
It'd be super cool. It would be super cool to do something like that.
Right.
Here's hoping. Fingers crossed.
I'm hoping for it too, because I want to hear it. I mean, I'm not a big audiobook fan, but that audiobook is one I would buy in a minute.
Yeah.
You wouldn't even have to do a sales pitch at all. I'd be pre-ordering it right now.
All right.
If she's listening, I'll pre-order 100 copies. Now, the pressure part, because it takes that one step further. This book belongs in a Coen Brothers movie. It has everything the Coen brothers do. It's except not a screenplay yet. That's the only. So the pressure part is, how do you get this to somebody? Because I've talked to 1,500 authors, and they all will. Oh yeah, sure. I'd love to see it made a movie. That's a pipe dream. This one is written to be. I don't know if you did that with intent, but it comes out like. It's tailor-made for the Coen brothers to get this book in their hands and say, read this.
Well, I didn't think of the movies or anything like that while I was writing the book. But when it came time to come up with a marketing strategy, you had mentioned at the top of the show that the schedule that I've been doing since January 5th, that was my first interview. We decided to start really promoting the book 10 months out rather than the usual 4 to 6 months out, in the hopes that, create buzz, get attention, get a lot of media hits to help my agent go in and sell something like this to the movies or the Netflix or whoever would like to buy. So I was really working hard. Then the writer's strike. So everything came to a screaming halt. So hopefully all that hard work, the beginning part of the year isn't lost, and we can still leverage that. And who knows, maybe lightning will strike and somebody will pick up the rights.
Well, I am nothing if not a supporter of the people who I have on my program. And I'm also a bit of a pit bull when it comes to, sending stuff out. And so I am definitely going to be pushing this idea, because it sounds like I have something. I love old time radio. It is one of my passions. This story. I love the Lone Ranger. I love old westerns. The book is something that I want to see made into a movie. I haven't even read the book yet, but I know enough about the book that I'm excited about reading the book. But I'm also excited about the next steps. And again, the audio. There's so much opportunity to do something that is not the typical audio book that everybody else does. So.
I can say it was a fun book to research. It was a fun book to write. And the book's only been out a day and a half. I'm hoping people think it's a fun book to read because I actually had a blast doing it.
Right. Now, last things I want to touch on before you go, the Buffalo connection here. Now, I noticed in, I don't know where I read this, but people who you were inspired by, authors you were, Kinsella and Field of Dreams type of thing, but also The Natural. I forget who wrote The Natural, but that's a Not Buffalo. Mel. That was filmed in Buffalo. Is that part of...
It was. And Robert Redford starred in it, and it was filmed around town. I must have been either a senior in high school or early days of college, because I was working at my dad's liquor store, and almost closing one night, and this guy comes in and he wanted three or four cases of New York State wine, but they had to have a real cork. And my dad, you know. He was this old Greek guy. What the hell for? You know, what are you doing? What do you want that for? And it turned out that he was buying champagne for the locker room scene in The Natural. Wow. And so we sold him some New York State champagne. Like I said, three or four cases. And if you go back and watch the movie, there's only one bottle of champagne in the whole thing in the locker room scene. But they bought four cases, so that made my dad happy. And that was my contribution to the movie, being an 18-year-old kid and ringing it up on the register for him. Carrying it out to the car for him, too.
Were you a big baseball fan? Because, I mean, the two of the influences are classic baseball stories. It seems like they must be up there.
I love those novels. Love the movies that were based off of them. And when I started writing Yesteryear, I already had written Muscle Cars, a short story collection, and Rook, which was based on a bank robber from here in Buffalo. And I felt like I wanted to do something bigger, you know, just something bigger, funnier. And I thought of those two books, and they're both baseball novels, like you pointed out. And so my mantra writing the book was swing for the fences with this one. You know, no character, no joke is off limits. No brush stroke could be too broad. You want Roosevelt in town? Put them in there. You want the mobsters to come in, the mafia, bring them in too. And, you know, if it doesn't work, you know, we'll fix it.
That's what I mean about being Coen brothers. Perfect. I mean, because that's where the Coen brothers would come in. They would take all these historically based facts, like, you know, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, where there's so much in there. And you can't tell where fiction starts and nonfiction, you know, or ends and all that kind of stuff. I love that. And they love that, too. So I'm not kidding, man. I will be sending this to people and telling people.
All right, I appreciate that.
I ordered the book, and we'll have it soon. And I look forward to reading it. And I wish you best of luck with it.
Thank you so much.
There's an actor from Buffalo who's remember his name.
Fichtner.
Yeah, Fichtner.
Yep.
Yeah, he's been on the program. He's kind of a friend of a friend, and has been on the program a couple of times. But yeah, we talked about the Buffalo Roots because he's from down here on Long Island, went up to Buffalo and lived his life up there. But he has Long Island roots, Farmingdale roots, and Buffalo roots, and we talked
about that. Yeah, he's always in town. So I haven't crossed paths with him yet, but maybe I'll slip him a copy of the book when I meet him.
Very cool. Yeah, well, I think I'm going to have him on in a couple of weeks. I will definitely mention the book to him and tell him that you are a Buffalo stalwart, a part of the community that is loyal to the community and inspired by the community, and because I know he is too.
Well, what's really cool is they're building a movie studio about 10 minutes from my house here in Buffalo. And they a lot of movies get made here because it's cheaper than New York or, you know, Toronto or Vancouver. And there's still a lot of old 19th century and early 20th century architecture that they like to use. And they have access to the lake and the river. So it's really kind of lending itself to movies and TV. So who knows, maybe the book will turn into a movie and they'll film it and produce it right here in Buffalo. And the city would love that.
Bill is an independent movie producer of his own, but I'm thinking Coen Brothers, man. Shoot for the stars, like you said. swing for the fences here.
Yeah, we're swinging away with this one.
Yeah, but I am. Thank you for knowing his last name, because I was having a senior moment there. Like, I know him so not that I know him so well, but I know I practiced, like, with your last name. I practiced it, and then I couldn't think of it. But I had an author on, Mary O'Donnell, who was also from Buffalo, and she took pride in Bill Fichtner being a Buffalo resident. Sure. Like, he's part of the pride of Buffalo, so
absolutely.
That's why I wanted to mention it. Anyway, it's been great having you. I love this story. I can't wait to get the book, and I will be an evangelist for it. And
appreciate that.
I just want to mention again that because I don't know if I even said this, the website is SG, you know,
Eoannou.
I'm sorry about that. SG Eoannou. Its spelling might be a little difficult for people, but the link is in the description for you, so you can go there and order the book today. Stephen, thank you for
thank you being so part much. It was a lot of fun.
Good luck, and thanks, I hope you take some rest after all these podcast interviews.
There's no more rest.
Okay. All right. Have a good night, and thank you for coming in. Best of luck.
Thank
to you. Bye for now. Stephen G. Eoannou, folks. Man, I had practiced that too, and then, you know, having a conversation is all it took to bounce that out of my head. Anyway, book sounds fascinating. If you like me, I'm sure you're going to love it. Order it. Order it. That's all I'm going to tell you. And if you know any connections to the Coen brothers to help me get this to them, help me send it my way. info@minddogtv.com. info@minddogtv.com. You think Eoannou is a tough name to pronounce. Tomorrow morning, I have two comedians on, and I can't pronounce either their first names or last names. So it's going to be really embarrassingly. And unlike the evening program, I don't get to talk to the guests before they come on to actually hear them pronounce their name. So I'm going to have my foot in my mouth pretty regularly tomorrow morning. Anyway, I hope you join me then. And let me know what you thought about tonight's program. So that's the show for tonight. Join me 9 a.m. for Coffee with the Dog. Till then, I'm Matt Knappel for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Don't forget to turn on your radio. Bye for now.
me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.